Hey brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick. You know, I made a couple of videos last night, and my microphone wasn't plugged in all the way, so the audio was totally destroyed, you know, so just a buzzing noise. Well, brothers and sisters, praise God, because we have victory over all things. I usually don't talk about it too much. We're just thinking about it, spiritual warfare, brothers and sisters. And what I was saying in my video last night, the hindrances that we go through seasons of hindrances, brothers and sisters. Seasons. And as they say, higher levels, bigger devils. And as I was saying last night, Goliath made David famous, brothers and sisters. You know, so we can be remembered for the problems we cause or the problems we solve. So King David became famous when he was a young man. He was anointed by Saul in secret, and they didn't tell he was anointed by the prophet Samuel in secret, and God didn't want King Saul to know. God told King Saul, you're so disobedient, I'm going to get a man after my own heart, and I will not allow your son to sit on the throne. I will end your dynasty. You're the first and last of your family. And he raised up a new one in secret, and that was King David. And then King David was only a teenager. And then later on, when David was sent, God made a way that he was anointed with the Holy Spirit, and King David would play the harp for King Saul. And it would make the demonic spirit leave King Saul, and that the Lord had sent to torment him, actually. It says, for his disobedience to God so much, and all the wickedness that he did. He even conjured up Samuel after he was dead through the witch of Endor, and that was the last straw with God. God had him killed after that, him and his family, his children and stuff. Was wiped out, except for one son who was crippled. So when they had the battle with David and Goliath, David defeated Goliath, and then they started singing a song. Saul has killed his thousands, and David has killed his tens of thousands. So David became famous in Israel, even though no one knew that he was already anointed to be king. He was still a young guy, like a teenager, maybe around 20 years old or so. And he defeated Goliath, and then the whole country knew who he was. He became famous because he defeated the giant. So, brothers and sisters, when we have challenges in our lives, see it as an opportunity. It's just a matter of not having the stinking thinking, but having the right thinking, that when we have these challenges in our lives, it's saying that, God is trying to prune me. As he says in John chapter 15, the Lord Jesus said that, I am the vine and you are the branches. Apart from me, you can do nothing. And my Father is the farmer, our husbandman in the King James. And he prunes those branches. And then the branches that doesn't bear fruit, of course, they're cut off and thrown into the fire, Jesus said. So when the Lord is pruning us and preparing us for the next level, if we would just, because we're going to go through it one way or the other. So the best thing to do is get that positive, be equipped with a positive mental attitude, and then you will know that, God is allowing this for a reason, for a purpose. He wants to raise me to the next level. God wants to give me more authority in his kingdom. He wants to give me more blessings. He wants to open new doors for me and new opportunities and move me on, that you can become a greater vessel for his honor, that we can be transformed, as the Bible says, to the image of Christ. That we can be transformed from a vessel of wood, hay and stubble, to a vessel of gold, to a vessel of honor. Tried in the fire, as it says, drossed seven times. Before I used to work in a place, when I got out of the military, when I got out of the army, I worked at a place where we made car batteries. And a lot of famous batteries. I mean, the Interstate is one of them. And I worked with a hot lead, we made these grids that go inside the batteries. And, with that hot lead, when it melts, it's like 700 something degrees, 800 degrees. And you have to, scrape the dross off the top. What that is like the impurities in the metal. It comes to the top, and then you take like a big spoon with holes in it, and you dip that stuff out, and then you let the rest of the lead drip out of it, and the chemicals, different mixes are made, just like with us. The Lord would make different mixes, you know. Look at, you know, all the apostles. You know, Paul was an educated man, and also very aggressive and very confrontational with people. The Apostle Paul was very confrontational and very aggressive. In writing, he said. In person, he said, I appear that I'm weak and not too much to me. But when I write, by the power of the Holy Spirit, my writing is very powerful and very aggressive. And then you've got the other guys who are fishermen. They weren't educated, but yet they just had this childlike faith, and God used them in different ways for His glory. So when you, like in a car battery, there's different mixes of different kinds of lead, in the lead, different calcium. They have these different chemicals you mix in there, silver sometimes, and all this to make positively charged grids, plates, negatively charged plates. And then different batteries for different things. You have marine batteries that are resistant to salt. And then you have batteries that are for cars, and batteries that are for lawnmowers, and batteries that are for tractors, and the big 18-wheelers. Different size batteries, different amount of power, different amount of reserve power. I could do a teaching all day long on that, brothers and sisters. But that's why when it talks about the 10 virgins, brothers and sisters, it talks about having that oil. You know, the five wise virgins, we're talking about Matthew chapter 25, talking about the rapture. The five wise had their oil, and then five foolish virgins did not have any oil remaining to have light to make it to the wedding. And so, brothers and sisters, it's a challenge to us. And so it just always goes back. That's why people are always looking for something new, some new thing. But you can, you know, and the Lord shows me new things and new revelations, but it always goes back to the basics. And that's the teaching that the Lord has given me, a teaching that I've taught 100 times before with the Filipinos all over the world, in America, in the churches I planted, and in the Philippines. Most times I don't repeat my message, but the one message the Lord gave me, and I made it on video before, is the three keys to victory. I'm talking about King David, as I was talking about in this video. King David, three keys to victory, and I need to make a whole new video and repeat it again, and then I can go into each one of them, but I'll just give you the quick one right now. We just talked about King David defeating Goliath. Now, how did he do that? You know, it wasn't that he did it, but it was God working in him that did it. So people get confused, and we can honor David, we can honor Paul, we can honor Peter and all those guys, but they didn't do anything on their own. And so I think we need to get that in our mind. As the video that I made last night, the Lord's bringing me back. It's the same message. I mean, thank God, that's how the Lord operates. The message He wants is from James chapter 5, and it talks about the fervent prayers of a righteous man availeth much. King James words there. You know, the intense, sincere, hardcore prayers of a man of God get a lot done. Okay, that's the Patrick version of that verse. Now, it also says in that same chapter, James chapter 5, it says that Elijah was a man with like passions like us. In other words, he made mistakes, but yet he was a mighty man of God. He called down fire from heaven. So take heart in the fact that Elijah wasn't perfect. Elijah even ran from Jezebel. And that's why I started making the video yesterday, was because of this Jezebel spirit. Some other people on YouTube are talking about the Jezebel spirit. Well, you know, it's huge in America. And it's one of the biggest problems in America. I wrote about it in the book, but not directly talking about the Jezebel spirit. I talked about, order and authority in the church and order and authority in the family that God ordained. And it's not politically correct, but God has set up His kingdom off of a model. God follows patterns in all things that He does. And in that pattern, the man is supposed to be the head of the household. It's the way God set it up, even as Christ is the head of the church. So the man is supposed to be the head of his household. And it's a whole nother sermon to say to men that, yeah, you're not supposed to lord over your family. Absolutely true. And the biggest problem is, when I talk to, the biggest problem I deal with as a pastor with women is their husband is not leading the family in Christ. I talk to lots of women. Look, I have someone in my family who's still alive who operates in the Jezebel spirit. They've been operating the Jezebel spirit, and they're 90 years old and still operating in the Jezebel spirit. a church breaker and a destroyer everywhere they go, their whole life claiming to be a Christian. And this person, as an example, this woman in my family, just like, so I guess I can say almost I'm an expert in this because I've been dealing with this person all my life, and I know their tactics, this Jezebel spirit. What they do is they neuter their husband, they neuter their male sons and children and grandchildren and all that. They neuter their all the males around them by any means necessary, which, like Jezebel, it can be a sexual thing. It can be in any kind of deceptive, manipulative way to emasculate men. And then, as the devil does with any sin he does to people, he's the one to turn around throwing the stones. And so what a Jezebel does is it neuters a man and then starts throwing stones, saying, well, I have to do it because my husband won't do it. You know, I have to lead because my husband won't do it. And all that. When in reality, they are the ones who undercut their husband and neuter their husband through all different kinds of means to manipulate, to put themselves over. Just as it says, God told Eve, your desire will be to be over your husband, but he will rule over you. And that's the situation. I know this is not a popular message. And I want to say this. Lots of women, I can just imagine as I'm saying this, they're saying, well, I didn't do anything to my husband. He's not leading. I'm sure that's true. It's to some people. It's not everybody. Not every woman is in the Jezebel spirit. There's some, a few, okay? But this pattern in our society has been set up by the Jezebel spirit, where the man is neutered. You could talk about it all day long. Look at the TV shows. The men are always goofy and stupid, as opposed to the 1950s, fathers knows best, beaver, cleaver. The dad is, responsible and has the right advice and all that. And the mom says, well, let's wait till dad gets home and let's talk about it and see what we're going to do. That's the modern day shows, is the man is a goofball. They don't want to get married. They don't want to take responsibility for getting a girl pregnant or whatever and all these kind of things. They're like a child, immature. That's what the world wants. That's what the devil wants. He wants to neuter men and take them out. So men are supposed to lead their family, but I will say this. I've said this before, and I said it in a positive way at Mother's Day every year. The problem with, when you have a church, they always want to, talk about people's birthdays instead of about Jesus, and they want to talk about Mother's Day and all that stuff. So, which I don't believe in doing that. I believe in talking about Jesus every time, but not getting into about people in that way. But Mother's Day, I always made it positive when I preached when I was pastoring churches. But the negative side of looking at that is every man, almost 100%, unless they're orphan, they've been raised by their mother. So the way men are acting, they learned it from their own mother and then on their wife. If they're, they're grown for a long time, they end up being more influenced by their wife than maybe their mother. And so women are in a position greater than men to make men, good or bad, to have a huge influence on how a man turns out. Women are the ones who are doing the primary nurturing and caregiving of children, boys and girls. And men are not in that role. Men, and I don't know why I'm talking this all practical stuff here, not spiritual stuff, but men are supposed to be the leader, not the boss of their family, not lording over their family, but the leader of their family, guiding their family in the ways of God, setting the example. The wife, well, especially small children, the nurturing and all that falls more with the wife. That's the way God planned it. Of course, as the children grow and get older, they become more independent, more, doing their own thing, and then they start, the dad can have a greater influence in those areas when they're, going out and about, especially boys and girls too. So we have a role to play, each of us do, and there, men cannot do it without women, and women cannot do it without men, and just a disclaimer, of course, there's lots of people who are single parents, men and women. There are men that are single parents too. But it's mostly women, that's true. And so that's the thing that we do. That's why we need God. Now, I'll say this, we all make mistakes. Anything we've done, we can repent of it and God will forgive us. That being said, we know that. But for future reference, for any of you who are watching this for future reference, we should ask the Lord to guide us in who we're going to marry, who we're going to spend our life with. You know, that the Lord would lead us to the right person. You know, most people, they get married, they don't consult God, or they don't obey God. They marry the wrong person. Lots of people, you know, a majority of people, maybe, I don't know, maybe it's 90%, I don't know. Because usually you're young when you get married and you don't have any sense. I mean, this is just how it seems to go, majority of people. And then we have all these situations, all these problems from our own decisions, you know, and that's where the rubber meets the road. That's where God, the Bible says, God causes all things to work together for the good of those who love him. Romans chapter 8, verse 28. God causes all things to work together for the good of those who love him, who are called according to his purposes. So, God can, you know, he already knew what we were going to do, and he predestines a destiny for us based off of that, the Bible says. Basically, God predestines a future for us. He designs a path for each of us, that he can get all the dross out of us, all the impurities out of us, all the glory out of us. You know, in other words, as an example, the Lord knew that the Apostle Paul, you know, he picked the Apostle Paul because he was, they said he had the equivalent of two or three PhDs in Judaism, you know, in the Old Testament. You know, so God chose him for that because he knew he had that education, and then he could use that to write all this theology stuff in the New Testament. That's why God chose him. Even though Paul had the weaknesses, they say he probably stuttered, he couldn't see good, all kinds of physical weaknesses. But yet God used him mightily in writing. Then the other apostles were fishermen. Jesus said to them, hey, follow me and I'll make you fishers of men. See, so the Lord took what they were already doing, they're already the life they had, and then just converted it right into for his glory. And that's what the Lord does for us. So even though I'm like the Apostle Paul right now, and the fact that, you know, the Apostle Paul kept saying, you know, I speak to you as men, not as, you know, as from a spiritual perspective, I speak to according to your flesh. And in this video, which I usually don't do, if you watch my videos, I'm speaking according to the flesh, the things I've been saying. But let's take it to the spiritual thing and say this. All things work together for the good of those who love God. So no matter what your situation is, you could be married to someone that turns out, oh, then tomorrow they come out, they're gay, you know, whatever. And say, oh, I'm such a bad husband or wife, I turned my spouse gay, or whatever you may think. You know, God already knew that was going to happen. And that's their problem between them and God. When they're doing something wacky, you know, we try to talk to them, we try to advise them, we've done the best we can. Hey, even your husband or wife, they still have their own individual responsibility to God. Second to you as their spouse, but number one is to God. They go off the deep end, off the crazy train. You know, you've done all you can. That's the only thing. Just like with your kids. A lot of people, of course, it's more personal or more hurtful when it's your kid, probably, than your spouse. And your kid goes off the deep end. They kill somebody, or they become a drug addict, whatever. And you say, what did I do wrong and all this? You need to go back and review if you did something wrong. There's lots of times, that's the problem with people want to hear someone tickle in their ears and some preach, oh, you didn't do anything wrong. Well, I don't know. Every situation is different. Sometimes we didn't do anything wrong. Sometimes you did do something wrong. And so what can we do? The problem with the world, when you go to a psychologist, they say, here, take some drugs, get all drugged up. And, you know, guilt is a thing that society is trying to put on you. The world and Christianity and religion and culture is trying to put guilt on you. Throw all your guilt away and get high on Prozac and all this different stuff. No, that's not God's way. God's way is, if you have a legitimate guilt, you need to repent of it. And then you're forgiven and you move on. You don't need to keep wallowing in the past. But there are people who have what they call neurotic guilt. It means they feel guilty over something they have no control over. I could be going there, oh, I'm just so upset about global warming, it's all my fault. Well, that's neurotic guilt. I mean, I'm not in charge of pollution. And as a matter of fact, you know, the global warming stuff is just a way to bring in, to fund the one world government through carbon taxes and all that. That's their plan, to fund the world government. David Rockefeller wrote a book about it in the 1960s. That was their master plan. That's why they started Earth Day. The man started Earth Day in 1970. They want to fund the one world government through carbon taxes, through claiming climate change. They wrote it down. Different story. Anyway, brothers and sisters, neurotic guilt is feeling guilty about something it's not your fault, you can't control. And there are people, I deal with people every day who have neurotic guilt. But the problem in the world is the fact that there's lots of people who should have guilt because they have not repented. And then that's the difference between being a Christian and not being a Christian. If you're a Christian, then you have repented, and therefore you don't need to have guilt about something you've repented about. In other words, you're insulting God, you're blaspheming the blood of Christ when you contradict the word of God. 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, he is just and faithful to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. So when you keep talking about what you did 10, 20 years ago, marrying the wrong person or whatever it is, I'm going to use an example, because we're talking about the Jezebel spirit as an example. You married the wrong person, whatever it may be. Once you repent of that, you got to move on. Now, sometimes we have to still deal with the consequences of that. Sometimes God will remove that harvest. He will cancel our bad harvest. As the Bible says, we reap what we sow. You know, the world says what comes around goes around. Same thing. What you sow is what you reap, good or bad. God can cancel your bad harvest sometimes. Sometimes he allows us. There's people that have killed somebody and they repented of it and they turned themselves into the police, and sometimes they got a lot of time in jail and sometimes they got a short time in jail. God predestines every situation for what he wants to accomplish and the way he wants to accomplish it. And he, just like Apostle Paul, he was thrown in the Philippian jail, and then the jailer got saved and his family and the prisoners and all that, because Paul was in jail, and then God sent an earthquake when Paul worshiped him in the midnight hour, as it says there. Paul in the Philippian jail, I believe it's Acts chapter 16. So, you know, God, even though for Paul, it sucked because he got beat, him and his sidekick, I think it was Silas, they got beat for casting a demon out of the python spirit out of that woman who was following him around. They were thrown in jail, and they were trying to preach the gospel. But like a lot of us, we'd say, well, Lord, why did you do this to me? Blah, 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 blah. They began to worship the Lord, and then God sent an earthquake. Their chains fell off, and the doors opened, and then everybody got saved. You know, and that was God's intention. So sometimes we had to go through something so that people get saved. That's just all part of the ball game. I was talking to a brother last night, you know, and we've been saying this. We've been talking about it, and I made videos about it way, way back. You know, the Lord is the coach of the basketball team or the baseball team or the football team, whatever you want to say. He's the coach. We're the players. He can put us in the play or have us sit on the sideline, or we can have a penalty in the game that sets us back, and then we have to wait. Like in ice hockey, you have to go sit in the penalty box. Whatever happens. But the end result is God already knew we're on the team. We want him to use us. We have to be ready to be used. If you go, you know, I'm changing messages. No, maybe I'm not. This is all the same message somehow. But, you know, if you showed up at the football game without your helmet, you can't play. If you showed up at the football game, you know, the hockey match without your stick, you can't play. You know, you got to have your uniform. You got to have your armor on. And brothers and sisters, let me, since I mentioned it, I forgot to say what's the three keys to victory of King David, which I will go back and make a new video about. First, he had a pure heart. He was a man after God's own heart. How did he have that? Relates to us being born again, repented, born again Christian, a pure heart. Secondly, Samuel anointed him with oil and anointed him. That oil representing the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit came on David. That's what was on him when he killed Goliath and proclaimed he would kill Goliath, was the anointing of God, the Holy Spirit. So you need to be born again. You need to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. And then the third key is you have to have faith. David here is a teenager. He went and got the 5 stones. Instead of wearing the armor of King Saul, which was way too big for him, and the sword of King Saul, he used a sling and a stone. And then David proclaimed that I killed the lion and the bear. So, you know, what is this uncircumcised Philistine? So I'm just doing the short version of this. Another thing is you have preparation. He killed 2 lesser beast before he killed the big beast, the giant. So he was in a preparation process too, to get there to where he was that day. He had already been prepared for that day, even though he was a young guy, like 17, 18, 19 years old. They always say 17, but the Bible doesn't clearly lay it out like that, but approximately 17 years old. So he had preparation too of other 2 smaller beasts he had to kill. So when he got there, he proclaimed, when he heard Goliath challenging the Israelites, and the Israelites are all a bunch of chickens, including his brothers, and King Saul, And then David, here he is a teenager, because of the power of the Holy Spirit, because of the pure heart he had, and because of the faith he had, he said, who is this uncircumcised Philistine to challenge the armies of the living God? You know, and that's a question that every mature, spirit-filled, pure-hearted, faithful Christian should say that when there's an attack from the enemy. Who is this stupid demon? Who is this demon-possessed psychic to challenge the armies of the living God? Whatever you're talking about. Who is this Jezebel to challenge the army of the living God? That's the question that we should ask, all of us. So what King David did, he even went out there on the field, and this is a short version, he challenged the giant. He said to the giant, you know, today, the giant said, you send this boy out to me? What am I, a dog? You send a boy out to fight me? You know, this giant, Goliath. And David said, well, you know, David declared by faith, I'm going to chop off your head and feed your body to the birds of the air. You know, he said it before he did it. That's faith. Before it happens, he said it. And then, to top it all off with, if you read the text, David ran toward the giant. He ran toward the giant. He's just a little runt. As a matter of fact, David was a little runt. He was young and short. And he ran toward the giant who was, you know, so it's like, dislike God to do that. That's the way God operates, brothers and sisters. You want to see how God operates? That's it right there. As another example, Jesus was born in a manger. They put him in a trough that the donkeys ate out of, in swaddling clothes, his rags. The king of the world, the king of kings and lord of lords, wrapped in rags and stuck in the trough that the donkeys eat out of. I'm sure it smelt like the manure of the donkeys and the, whatever they had there, camels, I don't know, whatever. There, I'm sure it smelled great where Jesus was born there. And then people say, oh, look at a castle. Look at beautiful the Vatican. And ooh, that's the opposite of God, brothers and sisters. God operates. He uses the simple things to confound the wise. In this natural flesh, God does things in a simple way to confound the wise. But of course, in the spiritual things, God, things are much more the opposite. Very deep. Very far, you know, very high, and of course heaven is the most beautiful place, a million times beautifuler than the Vatican or any other place you want to talk about. In that side, this side, God comes in a humble form, as he did when he walked this earth. It said he thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but humbled himself to the form of a man. You know, and he died even on the cross. I want to play a song for a minute here to finish this video up. God bless you guys. I want to pray for you, Father, in the name of Jesus. Lord, I ask you to bless your people, Lord God. Bless your people with your blessings, Father. Lord, we offer our sacrifices of praise unto you right now, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ. We love you, Lord. We praise you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for your Holy Spirit. Lord, I just release the anointing upon your people right now in the name of Jesus. Right now in the name of Jesus. Right now in the name of Jesus, I release the anointing right now of your health, wealth, wisdom, peace, joy, and love upon your people. Father, we thank you, we thank you, we thank you, Father, in the name of Jesus. We praise you, Father, in the name of Jesus. Brothers and sisters, I just wanted to mention this. I ask you guys to pray about it. I'm going to get the land, and I'm making another whole video about that. The house in another place. 2 hours in one direction is the land, the coconut trees and all that, and then 2 hours in the other direction from the other orphanages is a house that the Lord is leading me to buy. And I'm just going to say it. I believe by faith this is all for the Joshua's ministry. And I ask you to pray, and I guess be specific in prayer for this. We need at least $100,000, let's say $120,000 to do these two orphanages this year. One is already a house that's ready. That's the Lord has made a way and led me to this house for an orphanage in this city, half price what its value is. And that's a whole other story. I was going to make a video about it, but I don't need you. I'll stick it on here. I ask you guys to pray about that. The house is worth $120,000, and the Lord has made a way that the owner is compelled to sell it to us for $60,000. The land on the other end, we already have the money for. 4 hours away, the coconut farm. We have the money to buy the land, but to build the building, it's going to be basically $50,000 to $60,000, of course, to build the orphanage. That's what each orphanage cost. Total cost, $60,000. We've been doing a piecemeal in the past, you know, this part and that part, and not even getting it done right. But I know by faith, and the Lord has taught to me, he wants me to do it right, and not, piecemeal it, and not just hemming and hawing about what we need to speak and pray specifically what we need. We need $120,000, and nothing is too big for the Lord. That is nothing. The Lord owns the cattle on a thousand hills. He owns all the gold thereof. The Bible says God owns everything, and God will cause it to come into our bosom for His glory to do these two orphanages. And I ask you to pray in agreement with me about that, that the Lord will provide all of our needs. And like I said, the amount we need in funds is $120,000. I believe the Lord will provide it. We'll have it this year to build these two orphanages this year. And we already have the house parents. And I ask you to pray that, you know, that they're the right ones that we've got, and that they'll see it through, and that all the orphans will be the right orphans that the Lord wants us to have in the right place, brothers and sisters. Because there's kids in this place. If you had, let's just say this, if you had a child in your family, like a nephew or niece or a grandkid, and you couldn't take care of them and you had to send them to an orphanage, would you want to send them to an orphanage 4 hours away? Or would you rather have them be in an orphanage where you could go see them and visit them when you wanted to? That's why not only the amount of children, you can only have so many kids per building, per orphanage. Depends on the house parents and all that. 10 to 20 is about, 20 is the maximum I can do with one set of house parents, and that's already probably too much. I may even lower that to 15. I'm praying about that. Brothers and sisters, we have need in every place, and 2 hours apart is about the right distance, what the Lord's leading me to. I don't want to have kids 4 hours away from their grandparents. You know, the only person alive in their family is grandma, and they want to see their grandma sometimes. And 4 hours in the Philippines, you know, there's not readily available transportation. And the fuel, you know, we have a van there at orphanage number one. You know, it would be a month's worth of food to drive them that 4 hours back and forth, the fuel cost. So all of those factors, as the Lord has led, I go through the whole thing. But I'm not going to do it right now. But brothers and sisters, I'm asking those of you who are in faith, and those three keys to a victory, agree with me that God will provide these things. It's totally separate. But the video that I made, as I didn't even think about it now, it's connected. You know, this is a victory for Joshua's ministry this year. That's what the Lord has assigned me to do with Joshua's ministry this year, to have two more orphanages. One, we're going to build the building. We're buying the land and building the building. The other one is a great big house with 5 bedrooms that's ready to go in the right location, half the original price. I couldn't build it for what they're selling it for. And it's only a few years old. It's really from God. So I ask you guys to pray about that. And I got to make a down payment on the house, as a matter of fact, this coming week. And I'll use my own savings, of course. And I know God will make a way. God will provide. And let's pray. Let's worship the Lord, because we have the victory in Christ. Let's worship Him. The enemy's been defeated. Oh, yes. He's been defeated. Let's sing it. Let's make a joyful sound. Been defeated. The enemy's been defeated. Death couldn't hold you down. Yes, Lord. We're going to lift our voice in victory. Going to make a joyful sound. Hallelujah. Yeah, he's been defeated. Praise God. Hallelujah. 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 Let's lift our voice in victory. Hallelujah. Shout unto God. Hallelujah. You got to shout unto God. Hallelujah. Shout unto God. Brothers and sisters, I've been in that spiritual warfare before, brothers and sisters. And I had to shout it down. I've shouted down the strongholds before. And you got to shout it down, you know. You got to shout it down. Hallelujah. There's many times in the Bible I can do videos on that. Where the Lord, you know, I need to do a whole series on spiritual warfare. All the things the Lord showed me. I'm sorry I haven't made them already. Ask the Lord to forgive me for not making videos on all the things He showed me. Shout unto God. I can't really shout right now. Hallelujah. Shout unto God. Hallelujah. 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 The enemy's been defeated. Hallelujah. Brothers and sisters, praise God. That's Roy Fields, a man of God, used by God. He's the reason why they had a revival in Florida in 2008. Not because of that old Todd Bentley. The Lord sent the anointing because a man of God was there. That was Roy Fields, the worship leader there. That's him singing, "Shout unto God." Praise God Almighty, brothers and sisters. You know, I shout unto God and praise down through spiritual warfare sometimes by myself. And get that breakthrough. It's what you got to do sometimes. You got to get in the ring. You got to shout. You got to praise God, declare the victory that we got through the blood of Jesus, as it says in Colossians. You know, the Lord spoiled principalities. He defeated Satan and triumphed over him openly. The whole world saw Jesus defeat Satan. The whole world knows about it. They don't want to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, but they know that Jesus defeated Satan. Hallelujah. At the cross. Hallelujah. He bruised his heel on the cross as he crushed the head of the serpent. Hallelujah. Praise God Almighty. Hallelujah. That's why we have to shout. I'm not doing it now because it's kind of early in the day here. I don't want to shout. You know, the houses are jammed up here in the Philippines, but I will if I have to. But we got the victory. We've got the victory. We've got to shout unto God with the voice of triumph. Hallelujah. We've got the victory in Christ Jesus. There's tons of examples in the Old Testament where they shouted. You know, at Jericho, they shouted and the walls fell down. Hallelujah. It wasn't their shout, but God, you know, God told them to shout and they did, and God honored that shout. That shout. I need to do videos on that spiritual stuff, brothers and sisters. Some spiritual stuff. You know, that's how you get the breakthrough. You know, God is doing it. He sends angels to do it. You can get that breakthrough. You're doing your part to break through is to shout. Bring praises to the name of the Lord. Lift up his name and boom, you shout that. Just like when they blow those trumpets. You know, you're like a trumpet. You're breaking through, brothers and sisters. It's really true. I need to make videos about it. I'm just touching on this stuff. Lots of people, you know, that are carnal minded and not spiritual minded. They're not, oil is not full. They don't know what you're talking about. Lots of people don't know. But those of you who know me, you know I'm a servant of God. It's true. It's really true. You can lift your voice and let out a shout and praise God, and you can get the immediate end to the attack. You can bring down revival. I brought down revivals in churches by shouting unto God. You know, and praising, and he's holy, shouting, "Holy is the Lord, God Almighty," at the top of my lungs, and the power of God just fall. God honors that. You know, with God loves passion. Jesus was passionate. Go read the Gospels. Jesus was moved with compassion and moved to tears at the grave of Lazarus because of the lack of faith of the people and how death had a stranglehold on mankind. I'm sure the Lord was sitting there thinking, you know, the devil's really done a number on people. And it says another time in Matthew says that Jesus, you know, was compassion for the people because they were like sheep, you know, that had been tossed and thrown around by the enemy. And the Lord came to set things right. He said, "How often have I wished to gather you as a mother hen, but, you know, gathers her chicks, but you would not." People won't come to God to be set free. Stop turning to the world. Stop turning to psychiatrists. Stop turning to all this nonsense. Turn to Jesus. I gotta cut it off, brothers and sisters. God bless you. Praise God Almighty. Praise God Almighty. Praise God Almighty. He's been defeated. We got the victory through Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The enemy's been defeated. Hallelujah. Woo! We got the victory through Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Praise his name. Hallelujah.